Hello, this is Jameson with the St. Croix 40 Winter Ultra, and today we're going to be talking about stoves. Now there are three main stove types that are used most commonly in winter ultras. So we're going to take a look at those three today and go over some of the pros and the cons of each different stove type so that you can make a good decision about which equipment you want to bring to your winter adventure. So first, let's start with the granddaddy of them all, the white gas stove. So this here is a white gas stove, and these will burn all the way down to minus 40 degrees Fahrenheit, which is also the same minus 40 degrees Celsius as well. These stoves are powerful and they will get the job done in just about any condition. Now, having said that, these stoves are not the easiest to work with. As you can see, they're kind of bulky. You've got the stove itself, you've got all this tubing that connects the stove over to a gas canister that's got a pump on it that you have to connect and carry all of this with you. So they're a little bit bulky. So that's one consideration with these stoves. Secondly, they're not just a simple turn a valve, light a switch, or use your lighter to get the flame going. They actually take some work. And so, if you're going to use a stove like this, the most important thing is to practice. We have had multiple participants light their entire stove setup on fire during the event because they maybe weren't familiar enough with how the stove was working, or they got nervous using it. Need to be second nature when you're using these types of stoves. So on the other end of the spectrum, we have solid fuel stoves. Now these here are Espit tablets, and this is a small Espit stove. You can see here. And these are dead simple to use. All you do is you pop out a tablet, you place it in the stove, and you light it on fire, and it provides heat. Another beauty of these, they will last all the way down again to minus 40 Fahrenheit, minus 40 Celsius, even colder. I couldn't actually find an actual rating for how cold these would be. They're not gonna burn as hot as a white gas stove. So you will have to experiment on how many tablets you need, and you'll have to play with windscreens to kind of keep them the heat contained, because they're not going to burn as hot, but they will light. They will always light, no matter the temperature. They're super lightweight. These little stoves like this one here packs down into a little flat container shape like this, that you can actually put a couple tablets inside of this. This is super, super compact, super lightweight. However, again, you're going to want to always practice with all of these stoves and see how this works for you, for the amount of water that you need to boil for whatever meal you might be making, and base your timing on that. Finally, we get to the most popular of all the stoves, and that is the simple canister stove. These are by far the most popular stoves when you're outdoors. They use a small fuel canister attached to the base. They have some kind of a contraption or stove up top that you just simply turn the valve, light the gas on fire, and you get intense heat. You can boil water in 90 seconds, a lot of these say. These are some of the best and easiest stoves out there to use. So why don't everybody in winter ultras use these stoves? And that's because there's some downsides when it comes to temperature. Now, these canisters contain three different fuel types in them. Propane, which vaporizes or turns into a gas at minus 44 Fahrenheit or minus 42 degrees Celsius. They also contain isobutane, which vaporizes at 11 degrees Fahrenheit. That's positive 11 degrees Fahrenheit, minus 12 degrees Celsius. And then they usually have a small amount of something called N-butane, which doesn't vaporize except at 31 degrees Fahrenheit. So most modern canisters don't have more than 5% of the n-butane, so that's not a big concern. The problem is that only about 15 to 20% of your canister is the propane, which burns at minus 44. The rest is isobutane. And if isobutane vaporizes and turns into a gas that you can then burn at 11 degrees Fahrenheit, and you're doing a winter ultramarathon where the temperatures at night maybe get down to minus 30 degrees or lower Fahrenheit, this is going to be a problem. If this canister gets cold, the fuels inside it will not turn to gas and you will not get flame. So there are a few tips and tricks out there. I'll share a couple of them that I've heard about and tried that can help. One of those is keeping this canister warm. If you keep this canister, apart from the stove, in something warm, keeping it above freezing, or as close to above freezing as you can until you need to use it, it should light for a period of time. The longer you need to let these things burn, the more cold air that's going to hit it once you're sitting out there making your meal, and that propane's going to get used up real fast. And then all you're going to be left with is isobutane, and if it's colder than 11 degrees, you're out of luck. Another thing that people will sometimes do is many cook sets will come with a little measuring cup, just something plastic like this. Put the stove in the measuring cup to make sure that it's not touching the ground. You don't want the cold snowy ground to be cooling down your canister quicker than it needs to be. So that's one little trick to try and keep this above freezing. And a second thing is, if there's room in your measuring cup, put some water in here. Water, if it's not frozen, if it's liquid water, is going to be warm enough to insulate this for a period of time while you cook, try and get your meal cooked. So that's a couple little tricks to try and keep these things lit. If you are going to try and keep this thing warm, do not keep this against your skin. This is metal, and when it gets very cold, that could be very dangerous. So do not keep a canister against your skin when you're transporting it in the cold. You wrap it in some cloth, some blankets, etc. Maybe put it in some pockets. If you have kind of an internal vest, maybe something like that for that. So those are some of the things you can do to keep this warm. And if you can get this lit, it's going to be faster than probably all of these stoves that we've shown you here. However, if you can't get it lit, then you're in trouble. And in the super extreme cold temperatures, that's always going to be a bit of your challenge. And one other note about container stoves, make sure you're using a full container when you're setting out first thing in the cold. That'll give you the best chance of having a good mixture of propane and isobutane as you head out. So which of these stoves are right for you? White gas, solid fuel, container stove? It's up to your tolerance for risk. Are you willing to take a chance that you'll be able to keep your container stove warm enough to light when it's minus 25 degrees Celsius Fahrenheit or minus 25 degrees Celsius? Are you willing to take the risk that you can remember how to use your white gas stove properly and get it lit when your hands are cold and your hands are shaking? Are you willing to take the risk that you can keep an Espit stove warm in wind, warm enough so that you can get that water up to that boiling temperature so that you can make your meal or boil fresh water? Those are all the things that you're going to have to weigh and decide as you choose which of these stoves is right for you. We can't make that choice for you. Everybody has their own personal preference. Get out there in the cold. It's October here in Minnesota. We're already getting our first snow. We're already getting our first nights below freezing. Perfect time to go out. Pull your stoves outside at night and see how they light. And give it a try. We want everybody to be successful at St. Croix 40. We don't want anybody to go home feeling like they failed when it comes to these skill tests. The purpose behind what we're doing is to help you be successful at the bigger events where these types of stoves are necessary. Some of the later events that you might be competing in, such as Arrowhead and Tuscobia or even Iditarod, you need to know how to use your stove. You will be boiling water. And so we want to prepare you as best we can, and we hope that this quick overview of the stove types helps you make some smart decisions, and we look forward to seeing you in January out there on the trail, trying your hardest and seeing if you've got what it takes to survive a cold winter night in Minnesota. Thank you, and we'll see you on the trail.